forgiveness he gives to us and to be gathered together as his people. A few announcements as we begin today one. We're happy each and every one of you are here, especially our guests and visitors. If you're a guest or visitor and you're so bold as to raise your hand, we'd love to give you a small cross pin to wear and to keep to remind you of our Savior's love for you. And if you're not in the mood to raise your hand, I understand. After the service, be sure to talk with an usher or an elder in the back, and they'd be happy to give you a pin at that time as well. A few announcements as we begin today, and the first one, I invite Yvonne to come up and share with us an announcement from Puppets.
Good morning. If you came through the fellowship hall, you may have noticed we were having a little Thanksgiving treat sale this morning, and the kids were busy yesterday making those, and they're there to sell for you to take home and enhance your Thanksgiving celebration. They're darn cute too. So we also have our devotional booklets that we made up. This was a project that we started in, well, last year's festival theme was do something. And so we decided we wanted to do something for our community. And we thank Audrey Whitman and her son Kevin for being very instrumental in the donating of their time and to get these made. And there's pictures submitted by our puppeteers and our leaders, and they have a nice little Bible verse that goes with each picture, and so you can use them for every day of the month type of thing. Make a great Christmas gift. We're selling them for $5 a piece. The proceeds from this are gonna go to the NOW program, which is funded by United Way. It's nutrition on weekends. For kids, they get a backpack full of food that for kids that normally wouldn't have meals on the weekends, and so it helps supplement their nutrition that way. So when we sell all 100 of these, we're going to send a check for $350 to the United Way for that program. So it's for a good cause, so come back and see us after the service. Thank you.
Thank you, Ivana, and we appreciate it. We're blessed through the puppets, not only blessing our community, but blessing us this day through devotions and through those goodies. And then they already did earlier at our 8 a.m. service, and they will again later at our 10:30 service as well, bless us in worship with their musical talents. What a blessing the puppets are to us. A few other announcements as we begin today. One is an update. You know, these past few weeks we've been collecting money to support military Bible sticks, where we can send to men and women of our military the Bible in an MP3 format on a Bible stick. We just wanted to thank you for all your support in that. We raised over $1,500, which means it's enough to send 63 military Bible sticks to men and women serving our country in several places around the world. So we are very thankful for your support in that way. Another thing we'd like to make you aware of, and this is looking forward, starting this Wednesday at our Wednesday Thanksgiving Eve service, we're going to take a love offering for our social ministries here at church. And that love offering happens once a year, right around Thanksgiving, and that makes up their entire budget for the entire year. You may ask yourself, what does social ministries do? They actually do quite a lot, and so I'd direct your attention to this handout in the newsletter, but it tells us some of just the many things that social ministries does. Not only do they help our congregation and families in our congregation, but they also support so many ministries right here in Marshfield. They make a real difference, and they do all of that through the money that is generously given by our congregation right around Thanksgiving. So we'd encourage you to give and give generously to that in these services coming up in the next couple weeks. Along with that, we do look forward to our schedule around Thanksgiving time. Since Thanksgiving is next week, that means we have two chances to gather together here at church and thank the Lord for all of his gifts to us. One is Wednesday evening at 6:30, our Thanksgiving Eve service, and then another time we have on Thanksgiving morning at 9 a.m. So we look forward to seeing you then. Because of that, it means we don't have any Thursday night service this week on Thanksgiving. Also, we just want you to be aware of coming up very soon, actually, is our annual Christmas concert here at church. It's coming up on Thursday, December 3rd at 6:30. So it's the week after Thanksgiving. We'll gather here for that, and we hope to see all of you here with us. And two other things. One, the Baker's Dozen is selling their big books today in the narthex, or if you already have one, they're selling a new updated insert to the big books. We encourage you to check that out today, as well as all that the puppets are offering. And then finally, you may have noticed our church website has recently changed and been updated, responding to a lot of feedback from our congregation. It really looks great now. So we'd encourage you to check it out, to give us further feedback on it, but also to check it out and to connect with us in that other way. Our church website, the address is christmarshfield.org. Christmarshfield.org. We invite you to check that out in this next week ahead. Now we turn our attention to God's Word as we conclude our sermon series today, our sermon series, While We Wait. Today we're going to look at the letter of Jude, and our theme for today is, While We Wait, We Believe. May God bless us as we hear His Word this day, and as we grow together in faith through the work of the Holy Spirit in our midst. I invite you to join with me as we open our service today with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you yet again for gathering us together as your people to hear your word, to hear the forgiveness that you offer us, to rejoice in all you have done for us, and to grow in the faith that you have given us through the Holy Spirit. Lord, bless us as we wait, as we trust, as we believe in you, and wait for the coming of your Son and our Savior, Jesus, as we wait for him to come again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. That we join together and we sing our opening hymn today, Awake, O Sleeper, Arise from Death. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father, Almighty God. As we stand before your holy throne, we confess our unworthiness to be in your presence. Your law is perfect and true. We are by nature sinful, and we have failed to do what your law commands.
sin separates us from your holy presence. By the grace you show us in the salvation of Jesus Christ, clothe us in his righteousness, which we wear as your baptized children. Renew our hearts and strengthen our confidence in you and the free gift of your righteousness. Amen.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, hear God's word of mercy and his word of grace spoken to you. Almighty God, in his great mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for Jesus' sake, forgives you of all of your sins. Upon this, your confession, I, as a called and ordained servant of Christ, forgive you of all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Everlasting Father, you alone are the Lord of heaven and earth. Prepare our hearts for the coming of your Son, and as we joyfully await his glorious reappearing, we may find in him our righteousness and salvation. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Congregation may be seated at this time as we prepare to hear God's word for us this day.
The Old Testament reading for this, the last Sunday of the church year, is from Isaiah chapter 51. Give attention to me, my people, and give ear to me, my nation. For a law will go out from me, and I will set my justice for a light to the peoples. My righteousness draws near, my salvation is gone out, and my arms will judge the peoples. The coastlands hope for me, and for my arm they wait. Lift up your eyes to the heavens and look at the earth beneath. For the heavens vanish like smoke, and the earth will wear out like a garment. And they who dwell in it will die in like manner. But my salvation will be forever, and my righteousness will never be dismayed. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from Jude, beginning with the 20th verse. But you, beloved, build yourselves up in your most holy faith. Pray in the Holy Spirit. Keep yourselves in the love of God, waiting for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ that leads to eternal life. And have mercy on those who doubt. Save others by snatching them out of the fire. To others, show mercy with fear, hating even the garment stained by the flesh. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This time I invite the congregation to stand as we hear together the words of our Lord as found in the Gospel of today. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 13th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
And Jesus said, but in those days, after that tribulation, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts out its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all these things take place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But concerning that day or that hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard, keep awake, for you do not know when the time will come. It's like a man going on a journey. When he leaves home and puts his servants in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to stay awake. Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening or at midnight, or when the cock crows or in the morning, lest he come suddenly and find you asleep. And what I say to you, I say to all, Stay awake. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The congregation may be seated, and we'd invite any children to come forward at this time for a children's message. If we have any takers today, they must be taken up Sunday school today, which is a good thing as well. So if there's no takers, we'll continue on in our service at this time by singing together our sermon.
Thank you.
We continue to wait together for Jesus' sure and promised return. And as I mentioned before, our theme for this week is While We Wait, We Believe. If it's helpful or beneficial for you to follow along with such directing questions, I'd encourage you to look to the bulletin today to have some of those directing and focusing questions before you as we hear God's word proclaimed this day. You know, as I thought about the waiting that we do as Christians this past week, I was reminded of one of my favorite movies, because the movie has many similar themes to those that we have covered in our series. In fact, it is a movie essentially about waiting. The movie stars Tom Hanks, and it is called The Terminal. Perhaps you've seen it before yourself. See, Tom Hanks' character in the movie is a man named Victor Naborski. He's a resident of the fictitious country of Krakosia, and he's visiting New York City. At least, he's trying to visit New York City. Because you see, as Victor Naborski is in the air, his home country, it dissolves into a political insurrection. And so when he lands in New York, he is told that his passport from Krakosia is no longer valid. He won't be allowed to enter New York City, but he also can't board a plane back to his war-torn country. He's a citizen of nowhere, and he is told that he's unable to do anything about it except wait in the airport terminal. Well, throughout the movie, as Victor Naborski waits for days and weeks and even months, he experiences many of the themes of waiting that we have talked about in our series, too. At one point, Victor cries as he watches the images of his country being torn up by war on the banks of television screens in the terminal. But at other times, Naborski celebrates. He celebrates even the small victories of learning that you can earn a quarter by returning a lost luggage cart back to where it's supposed to go. And after he has learned that system, he then celebrates by heartily enjoying a hard-earned lunch at Burger King that he's able to buy from all of those quarters. Throughout his waiting, Victor also encourages almost everyone he is in touch with. Encourages a luggage transport driver in his romantic pursuit of the friendly TSA agent. He encourages and helps a fellow foreign traveler who is being denied entry because he is bringing prescription medicine to an alien father without the proper documentation. And all the while, through Victor's tears, and through his celebrations, and through his encouragement, Victor Naborski waits. And in that waiting, he displays a faith that day he is waiting for will one day come. You know, waiting naturally signifies a belief in something yet to come, doesn't it? Nobody waits for something that they don't believe is going to happen. And so as we wait together for our Lord's return, we are at the same time testifying by our waiting. We testify that we believe that that day that we wait for will eventually and surely come. See, waiting is an act of faith. And because it is, the devil would have us give up waiting altogether. See, the devil would have us doubt God's promises for us in this life. He would have us stop faithfully waiting for the Lord. He'd have us seek after our own gain. The devil would have us chase after something else entirely, and he'd try and get us to do it by whispering things in our ears like, live for the moment, live for yourself, or even, he might say, YOLO, you only live once, so you better live for yourself. The devil would have us live lives that are all about ourselves, that are distracted, or even that lead us to totally forget what we are waiting for in the first place. You know, the devil would have us stop gathering together as God's people like we're doing today. He would have us stop reading God's word and so remind ourselves again and again of what it is we are waiting for. The devil is all about doing anything and all he can to get us to stop waiting for what our God has promised will come. That's the truth of the matter. The sad truth is that so often in our sin, we hear the devil's lies, and we believe them. We lose sight of what it is that we are waiting for in our lives here on earth. We chase after cheap substitutes that are worth far less than what God calls us to wait for. Lord, forgive us. Forgive us when cheap substitutes in our world divert our attention away from something that is so much more important. You know, Viktor Nevorsky faced a similar temptation himself in the terminal. See, after repeated failed attempts from this guy, Frank Dixon, the airport's director of customs and protection, after repeated attempts from Frank Dixon to kick Viktor Nevorsky out of the airport, Dixon develops a new idea. He'll tell Viktor that the doors to New York City are open for 5 minutes. And then Dixon will move security guards away, and he'll tempt Viktor Nevorsky to live for himself, to take matters into his own hands, to make a break for it into New York. And when he does, Dixon's plans are to have grounds then to arrest him and to deport him. And so Dixon sets his plan in motion, and he watches as Nevorsky moves toward the doors to the airport on a bank of security cameras. But then as he watches, he sees that before Viktor goes out the door, he stops. And then Viktor realizes what it is that he is about to do. He realizes that if he goes through those doors, he would be settling for a cheap substitute that would deliver less than what it was he was waiting for. In fact, if he walks through those doors, he would actually be foregoing the thing that he had waited so long for in the first place. So Viktor Nevorsky turns around and he peers into the security cameras and he delivers a message. He boldly proclaims in broken English, "I wait. I wait." Just 2 words, but 2 words that clearly show the faith that he has, that all of his waiting in that airport will one day end. And when it does, then it will be worth the wait. Isn't that the same thing that we do as Christians, waiting on Jesus to return? Through the strength of the Holy Spirit, we wait and we believe that that day that we are waiting for, we believe that it will come to be. When we read God's word, by our actions, we are boldly proclaiming, "I wait." And when we gather here at church together as God's people, we are saying, "I wait." And when we confess our faith in the words of the creed, we are proclaiming to all who will hear us, "I wait." And even when we come to this altar, when we receive the forgiveness of our sins through the body and blood of Jesus, we proclaim to the devil and to the world and to everyone else, "I wait for Jesus to return." And as we wait, God strengthens us in the faith in what we are waiting for. You know, it's kind of like a man who's sitting at a train station, who's waiting for his train to come. Imagine this man, if you will. He's sitting there in the waiting area at the train station, and he believes that a train will come and get him. And his faith, it isn't blind. It's not simply made up. His faith is supported. It's supported by information on a train schedule that's posted nearby. Just like our faith is supported and strengthened by God's word that we have read and that we hold dear. But you see, that's not the man's only encouragement to believe. His faith is further supported by the other passengers that slowly gather around him, waiting for the same thing. We experience that too here at church, don't we? As we gather each week to continue our waiting, we are reminded that we are not alone in that effort. Look around. Look around at your brothers and sisters in Christ sitting around you this day. They wait with you. The church around the world and believers of all time, they wait with you too. And as you wait, your faith, our faith, is again strengthened. But you know, that's not the only reasons to believe either. In fact, if those were the only two reasons that we had to wait and to believe in what we're waiting for, if those were the only two reasons, Christianity would sound an awful lot like every other religion in the world. Think about it. Written words that testify to a belief, and then other people who believe what you do. Almost every other religion in the world can claim the same thing. So what sets what we wait for as Christians apart? And the answer to what sets us apart is actually who sets us apart. It's Jesus. You see, our man who's waiting in the train station, he believes that his train will come because it's happened before and because he's been given a guarantee that it will happen again. The man's guarantee is from the train company. It's in the form of a ticket that he holds in his hands. As we wait for Jesus' coming, we know that it has happened before. And we've been given a guarantee that it will happen again. You see, our God has given us a guarantee in the form of his Son. Hebrews 7:22 says that Jesus is the guarantor of a better covenant. Jesus is the guarantor of God's promise. We believe that Jesus will come again because he has come before. And when he did, he came to earth and he lived the perfect life that you and that I fail to live at every turn. And then Jesus died upon the cross to forgive us of our sins, to forgive us for our impatience, to forgive us for our lack of waiting, to forgive our sinful chasing after the things of this world over and above the Savior of it. See, Jesus came to forgive us of all of our sin. He came to earth just as God had promised, and before he ascended, Jesus promised that he would return. So the man looks at his train ticket, a guarantee that his ride will eventually come. How much greater, brothers and sisters, can we believe that our Savior will surely return? For we have a guarantee, not in the form of a ticket printed on paper, but rather we have a guarantee in the form of a nail-ridden cross and an empty tomb and a Savior who lives and who has promised that he will come again. This belief that we have, it shapes the way that we wait. Because since we believe and trust that one day Jesus will return to judge the living and the dead, how then should our lives look? How then should we live? Well, Jude told us that too, didn't he? In verses 22 and 23. He calls us to show mercy to those around us, show mercy to those outside the faith, that they might believe in Jesus too. and show mercy to our fellow brothers and sisters in Christ in light of the mercy that we have received from Christ ourselves. And just as our waiting shows a belief in Jesus' promised return, our acts of mercy shows our belief in the mercy that Jesus has shown to us. And so while we wait, we believe. Like Victor Nemborski, sometimes our waiting is filled with tears. Sometimes it's filled with celebrations. As Christians, it's often filled with encouragement for God's people to keep waiting for that day. Through the Holy Spirit at work in our lives, we believe that according to God's word, according to his promise, we believe that that day will certainly and surely come. And so as the letter of Jude ends with these words of blessing, so too does our sermon today. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence with glory, with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, with glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now, and forevermore. Amen. Having heard God's word, we have a chance to confess together that we wait for the Lord, and we'll do that today through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I invite the congregation to stand as we confess our faith together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Congregation may be seated at this time as we worship the Lord with our offerings, and as always, I encourage you to find a record of fellowship and fill it out to pass it to those sitting next to you so that following the service, you can greet them by name in the name of the Lord. We continue in our service. We do so in prayer, and for that, I invite the congregation to stand as we pray together this day. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs, for the advancement of Christ's kingdom, that we may share the gifts of our Savior in both our words and actions. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, you alone give righteousness and salvation for all those who are united to Christ by holy baptism, that they may walk in newness of life. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, you alone give righteousness and salvation. For all pastors and teachers and missionaries and other servants of the church, that they may both be taught by our Savior and teach others his love. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, you alone give righteousness and salvation. For our congregation, that we may work together in unity for the sake of Christ and his mission, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, you alone give righteousness and salvation. For all who serve in positions of leadership in our government, along with those who serve in our military, that the Lord would always be their refuge and strength, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, you alone give righteousness and salvation. For all who are broken in heart, mind and body, pray a prayer of safety for all those who are traveling in this week ahead, and a prayer of safety for all those who are out in God's creation and hunting in this weekend or in these days. Lord, for all these people in any time of need or in a thanksgiving, we pray that they would know your grace and would know the healing that comes from Jesus in body, mind, and spirit. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, you alone give righteousness and salvation. For these and all other concerns we have, that coming before the throne of grace, we find mercy to help us in every type of need, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, you alone give righteousness and salvation. Amen. Taught by our word and trusting his promises, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Lo, he comes with clouds descending, once for every sinner slain, thousand saints attending, swell the triumph of his train. Alleluia, 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 Christ the Lord returns to reign. Depart this day with God's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and grant you his peace. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And the Lord bless you not only this day, but throughout the week ahead, as we continue, as God's people, to wait, to believe in that day that our God has promised will certainly and surely come. And God bless you in our waiting together. We close our service today by singing together our final hymn, Thine the Amen, Thine the Praise.